y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy. Folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and all of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
I want to ask the, make a walking exclamation point to the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you. There is a whole lot of worshiping going on this morning. Even in the midst of where we are right now, very symbolic to Mars Hill. Mars Hills was a place known as the Arrow Pegasus. It was a court that sat in the open air of benches, three sides slightly elevated, therefore providing a quadrangle, if you will, with short flights of 16 steps leading to what is called the Arrow, and then reaching the plateau, where the court was held cut out of white rock. Paul stands and he looks to his right, he sees the temple of Epimenes. Then shortly facing him was the temple of Thessalus. And then there was Acropolis of Pythium. The height of Mars Hill stood directly above him. At its highest point was a colossal bronze statue of Athena, as a tutelary or position of guardian and protector of Athens. The Greek religion was merely a place of defecation of human attributes to the power and the nature of God. Quite frankly, at Mars Hill, every philosopher, every Epicurean, every thought process was there to be given to a God. And whatever a person believed seemed to be right, as men worship God as they would in their own mind. And every mystic thing that would happen, they would name a God behind it. If a lightning fell from the sky, they would give it a Greek God's title and name and worship it. Sounds so much like today, where men and women all around this world this morning, in their disrespect and arrogance to God, has said to the Word of God, that God is who I make God to be.
Man.
God is how I see God to
be. Oh, yeah.
And God will do what I say God will do.
Preach.
It's this point that Paul will look at them, and he will now echo the sentiments, as the scholars will echo the sentiments of Paul, and which Huizen said, who wrote the classic book, Life of the Epistles of Paul, it was a religion which ministered to the art of amusement and was entirely destitute of moral power, pages 280 and 281. In other words, oftentimes we see folk jumping and dancing in church and moving around, and we will smile and laugh like they're really having a good time. Well, on Mars Hill, they sure knew how to have a good time. Barclay wrote that it was the ideal that religion was a concept in which something spooky happened, immediately required that a God was attached to it. How many times have you heard people declare and shout that I was riding down the road and suddenly I heard a voice from heaven and I saw a strange image that I'd never seen before.
Well,
and I know that was God that spoke to me. But I want you to know that if spooky things and miracles could change or save somebody, during Jesus' day, the whole world would have been saved.
Man.
To see a man walk on water at 4 o'clock in the morning, I know somebody would have been saved.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes.
If miracles would have saved somebody, as many blind people that received their sight, I know somebody would have been saved. If miracles would have saved somebody in biblical days, to see somebody raised from the dead, I know somebody would have been saved.
Man.
But the fact of the matter is, John declares in John 20 and verse number 31, that these miracles happen that we might believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
Man.
And when you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, it's not because of his miracles, it's not because of his blessings, it's not because find people like this. The first thing that we must do, we must act, but we must refuse to acquiesce into counter arguments with him. Notice that Paul approaches Mars Hill with philosophers and all type of religious beings. He says, I beheld your devotion. I found that they are too superstitious. But rather than argue about what scripture was right and what scripture is wrong, he found a conciliatory point in which he can make his case. Number one, he wants to make his case that at least you believe that there is a God. Amen.
Uh-huh.
See, that's a problem today, that most folk don't believe that there is a God.
Yes.
And sometimes when your Bible says in your study, maybe you need to just start that the fact that you believe that there's a God.
Man.
Well, how do you know? He said, well, I saw an altar over here. Now, I saw a whole lot of altars, saw a whole lot of statues, saw a whole lot of foolishness, and a whole lot of witchcraft and debauchery and superstition and religious acts. But I notice over here you have something called to the unknown God. And since you have an unknown God, let me declare to you God that I serve. And I want to name this sermon this morning that God don't need your help. Y'all like say amen.
Amen.
God doesn't need your help. Let me declare unto you that when God established his church, he didn't need any philosophers. He didn't need any teachers that walk around who taught something different. He didn't need the most profound minds on the face of the earth. When God had church in his mind, he did it before the foundations of the world and did not require your approval or your input in the church.
Man.
You ask what's wrong with people today? People have gotten too smart for themselves. Man. Oh yeah, you're so smart, you done got it all figured out. And you become arrogant, you become disrespectful, you become dishonorable, you become ungodly, and God said, I need to declare, I need to teach you who God is.
Man.
And the first thing I need you to understand is that God, the God that created the heaven and earth, don't need your hands on his stuff.
Well,
and I say amen.
Man.
Look at the verse you'll find in verse number 23, for I passed by and held your devotion. Let me drop down, down to verse number 24. The Bible says, God who made the world and all the things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands. Mm-hmm. Well, some people say, well, he's just saying that, one foolishness, this happens in the church. This is what I call idiosyncrasies of just an idiot by idiot. Start teaching that Acts chapter 17 and verse number 24, that not with hands meant that you couldn't clap your hands.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's about as crazy and uncontextual that I've ever heard. Let me tell you something. God says that in heaven that there's a clapping of hands when it comes down to giving him glory. God says that we ought to lift up.
Yes.
We ought to lift up.
Lift up your hands.
We ought to lift up. I'm just trying to find five people full of spirit. That we ought to lift up holy. Y'all know what I'm saying? Holy hands.
Man.
But contextually, Paul, Luke was not writing to condemn clapping of hands. As a matter of fact, I clap my hands when I get ready to clap my hands to give God glory.
Man.
Because he gave me these hands. Y'all ought to say amen.
Man.
If God's been good to you, you just give God a hand clap right now.
Man.
You give God a high five. Turn to your neighbor and give him a high five right now. You serve a God that's supposed to be praised by your hands.
Man.
But here's the problem. Contextually, he is teaching that you can't make God and who you want to make God into. How do I know? He said, I passed by your devotion, and I saw in the midst of Mars Hills all kind of statues, which I described to you. In verse 21, he said, you Athenians, strangers, which spent their time for nothing else but to tell and to hear some new thing. When we look at what has transpired, even over the last couple of years, they've come up with some new things. And the church is sitting by quietly looking at a modern day Mars Hill.
Well,
God taught in the days where there was just Adam and Eve that for this cause shall a man leave his mother and his father.
Yes, he did.
He shall cleave unto his wife, and there should be no more twain.
Yes.
But there should be one flesh.
Preach, preach.
Ah, but back here on Mars Hills.
Yes.
Proposition number 8 came out. And they got out some new thing.
Mm-hmm.
Where God must have gotten it wrong. And now there are some churches, the United Church of God in Christ, that teach that a man can lie down with a man as woman.
Wow.
woman can lie down with a woman as woman and grab hold of each other and haul each other up and squeeze each other, that God has now okayed what he has prohibited. Y'all sitting there looking at me funny.
Well.
But in Mars Hill, crazy teaching is taught. Mm-hmm. Mars Hill, some new thing is taught. Even in the body of Christ, where was the church as this new thing was taught? Mm-hmm. Somebody said, well, in the church, the man of God is just another man. And we ain't got to respect the man of God. He's just another brother. You done put your hands on something that God has put together from the beginning of time.
Well.
And the reason that you're going to hell is that you're trying to fight the man of God.
Preach.
And the reason that the spirit of God has left you is because you have the spirit of Korah inside of you.
Uh-huh. Yes, sir.
Disrespectful, dishonorable, and rebellious and hard-minded were the people on Mars Hills. Mm-hmm. And I dare say that they are disrespectful and dishonorable, horrible representation of Christianity in this church right now this morning.
Amen.
I need to declare something to you, that God didn't have to ask you if he have instrumental music in the church or if he wouldn't have instrumental in the church. God simply told us what to do.
Amen.
And that ought to be good enough.
Yeah.
But in Mars Hill, they came up with a new thing. And in that new thing, they said in Ephesians 5, verse number 19, that you would have instrumental music because the word silo had instrumental music in its definition. But I stopped by to tell you by the preponderance of evidence that when God wrote in Colossians that our sons are to teach and admonish one another, that the melody should be made in our heart. He didn't change that because you came up with a new thing. Am I right about it?
Man.
When God declared in Hebrews chapter 13, around verse number 17, let us offer continuous praise unto God that is with the fruit of our lips. He didn't have to tell us that we couldn't have instruments because he told us what instruments to use.
Amen.
When he came down to praise him. Am I right about it? I know y'all looking at me funny right now because I'm in Mars and I must be preaching from Venus, but I'm preaching from the word of God, and you Martians gonna get the truth this morning.
Man.
You Martians gonna learn that God don't need your hands in order to establish worship in the house of God.
Man.
So let me declare something unto you. Y'all doing a lot of foolish stuff, throwing up idols, throwing up stuff that I have not authorized. And I don't need your help. I'm reminded of what he said in verse number 25 of the text. Neither is he worshiped with man's hands. I mean, you can't make worship what you want to make worship. He don't need anything from you. He don't need your talents or your gifts. He needs your obedience.
Man.
He needs you to read the scripture.
Preach.
And hear the scripture.
Yes.
And do what the scripture says in the scripture. Am I right about
it?
He needs you to look at Ephesians 5:19, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs.
Yes, sir.
Singing, making melody in your heart unto the Lord. Am I right about it?
Man.
He needs you to follow his example.
Preach.
Hebrews 2 and verse number 9 through 12. But now to see Jesus, who was made a little lower than angels, who became the captain of the suffering of our salvation, saying, I will declare unto my brethren in the midst of the charge,
yes,
I will sing praises unto you.
That's
he
what
needs
said.
You to follow his example and not your own example.
There you
he don't need your help.
Preach.
On the piano. He don't need your help on the guitar. He don't need your help with the drum. He needs your submission and your obedience to the word of God.
That's what it says. Preach.
You just can't make church whatever you want to make church. And I declare unto you that even to today, this very day, that God wants you to take your hands off of his directions.
Mm-hmm.
You remember what God said in his word in Psalms 105 and verse number 15, for you preachers ain't nobody. He said, don't you put your hands on God's anointing. There are different ways of putting your hands. Y'all ought to say amen.
Man.
On God's anointing.
Well,
I don't care what you think about God's anointing. Don't you put your hand on the man of
that's
God.
That's what he said.
The reason you live in a cursed life because you are undermining rattlesnake.
Uh-huh.
The reason you live in a cursed life because you think you can sin and worship and the man of God can't say nothing. The reason God is wrecking hell in your life is because you put your hand on the man of God.
Man.
He said, let me tell you something in Psalms 105 and verse 15. Touch not mine anointed and do my prophets no harm. I want you to understand that every time you try to tear down the man of God, God not only will build him up, but he'll rip you.
lips of the men of God.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Giving reverence and praise, it's a nasty shame that folk come to the house of God and God's using the men of God and the people of God are sitting in church. See, this is why Paul didn't out and out attack the Athenians, because the Athenians had some wise guys that were in there. And the last time that Paul witnessed somebody challenging them openly in an aggressive manner, because he did teach them, was when Jesus stood up and told them, I am the Son of God. Right. And they declared to him in John 11 and verse number 11. He said, we have a law. And by our law, you ought to die. Because you have made yourself the Son of God. He didn't have to make himself the Son of God. He is
Amen.
God.
Amen.
He is the only God. Amen. And that God is coming back again. Not just for everybody, but for his church. Amen. For those who are called, let the redeemed say so. He's coming back for those who are in his church and not a church in Mars Hills.
Amen.
And that's the problem. Some of y'all think when God get back, he's going to get all the good people out of one statue and all the good people out of another statue. Well, you was repping Apollo, so you come on in. Listen, you was good with John the Baptist, you come on in. And you was a great Calvinist, you come on in. The Bible don't teach that. No, sir, he don't need your hand, he don't need your hand. And you might not like it, but the truth shall set you free.
Amen.
You need to leave Mars Hill and come to what the Messiah has put together. And you need to understand that he doesn't need your hands on his stuff. As a matter of fact, all of those statues and all of those churches who are not under the banner of Jesus Christ, who God has not bled for on Calvary's cross, who God did not resurrect, who God does not identify by name, who God does not identify by doctrine,
well,
of the accursed things of God. Well. And he says in Philippians, or I believe Philippians chapter 2 or 3, touch not, taste not. Mm-hmm. Some stuff you ought not touch and ought not feel about. As a matter of fact, in Joshua 6 and verse number 18, there were those who had went down in the battle and touched the accursed things of God. And God cursed the whole temple. Mm-hmm. Well, what are you saying? Whenever you allow false worship, false spirits, false attitude. Some people say, why are you always telling them folk they got to give God glory? Because I'm trying to stop them from contaminating the worship of God.
Amen.
You can't let
Amen.
Devil sit up in the house of God and not make them say amen.
Amen.
Every devil going to have to shout and give him praise. Amen. For at the name of Jesus, every tongue
shall come. Yes, sir.
And since you came into his house and you enjoyed his air conditioner, sitting on his chairs, wearing his clothes, eating his food, communing in line, you ought to be able to shout.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Somebody ought to make you shout.
Uh-huh.
Thank you, Jesus. You old devil, you shout. Stand up and say amen.
Amen.
You ought
amen.
To give God glory.
Yes, sir.
In the house of God. Am I right
amen.
About it?
Amen.
We look, we find that not only does Paul tell them that God does not need your hands, does not need your ideology, for your thoughts are not my thoughts, nor your ways my ways.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I don't even need your thought process. I don't even need you trying to counsel me. And there's some of y'all that are in the house of God that are trying to be God's counsel.
Man.
Sitting up in the house of God in psychology, we learned that everybody have what is called soft voices. Soft voices influence us. Soft voices is that stuff when you're walking around and you're talking to yourself in your head, and you're telling yourself, you know, I think I'll have a V8 today. Amen.
Yeah.
You know, I think I'll sit over there. It's going to be nice today. Not bothering anybody, but in your soft voice, you're guiding yourself and you're directing yourself. And in your soft voice, sometimes you block out the voice of God, the Holy Spirit that's leading you. Sometime in your soft voice, even in Mars Hill and in the house of God, you'll hear the word of God, and your soft voice will start saying, I'm not going to shout today because I don't want him to think that I support him.
Uh-oh.
I'm not going to give God glory because I don't want folk to see we have a good time at the church.
Oh, yeah.
I'm just nasty enough that I'm going to sit in here and I'm going to look crazy. So just in case the camera look at me, I can get me two more folk to hell where I'm going in the first place.
Uh-huh.
But your soft voice need to understand that God's will be done.
Amen.
And if you won't praise God in the house of God, there's about 5 or 10 people in here that'll stand up right now and give God praise
Amen.
Right now and shout.
Yes.
Jesus, even if you won't shout.
Yes, sir.
Praise God. Let me stand by the end. If y'all sit down, I'm going to keep preaching. I'm going to keep preaching for a minute. I'll try and let y'all go home.
Stand up for Jesus.
Ain't nobody mad but the devil. Am I right about it?
Amen.
He tells them that I don't need your hands. I don't need your mental help. But what I need to tell you that God, who created the heaven and the earth, has hope for all of those who will receive him as God all by himself.
Mm-hmm.
I want you to know that this text indicates that every now and again we follow flight of false doctrine, false ways, and false lies, but thanks be to God that there's hope in the Lord. Am I right about
Amen.
It? Maybe you don't know God like I know God, but I'm telling you, he's a mighty, mighty good God. Am I right about
yes,
it?
Yes, sir.
He's a loving God. He's a will in the middle of the wheel. Am I right about it?
Amen.
He's a patient God. Been better to us than we've been to ourselves.
Amen.
He put on the earth water before we needed water. Am I right about
Amen.
It? Clouds before we
yes.
needed clouds. Am Amen. I right about it? He put chitlins on the hall before we even start eating chitlins. Y'all ought to shout.
Yes,
he made pork chops.
Uh-huh.
Hot sauce. Am I right about it? The hot sauce came after the pork chop. Isn't God good? Am
yes,
right
he
right
is. Yes,
he's God all right this morning.
Preach it.
He's God all by himself.
Amen.
Even before, when we didn't know love, he looked at man and said, man, it's not good to be alone.
Uh-huh.
I'll make him a woman before he knew he needed a woman.
Man.
And how dare some of us to say that God got it wrong? I needed a man.
Well.
If you needed a man, he'd have made a man.
Amen.
But he made a woman.
Praise God in here.
God,
yes,
sir. He'd be good. But to God, that you as you glad God made woman, won't you shout amen right now?
Amen.
Somebody shout, thank you, Jesus. Won't you glad you ain't got to marry Jesse?
Oh, yeah.
Girl, thank you, Jesus. Could y'all say amen? And you glad you ain't got to walk down the aisle with Charles?
Man.
Can't you say amen?
Amen.
Isn't God all right?
Yes,
he
is.
I'm going to start shouting right now. Isn't God all right?
Praise
him. Amen.
Yes, sir.
It's then only then that the text will go ahead and conclude that there was some in verse 33 to 34, some departed from among Paul's preaching, howbeit certain men cleaved unto him and believed that, that there was one God who made the heavens and the earth. And there were some that obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ. They could claim and shout from the rooftop that the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul.
Yes.
He leadeth me in the pathways of righteousness for his name's sake.
Amen.
Yes, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thou rod and thou staff. They come from him, am I right about it?
Yes, sir.
Thou prepared the table in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil in my cup.
Run it,
my cup. My cup.
Yes.
My cup. My cup runneth over.
Uh-huh.
Somebody said, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Amen.
And I shall dwell in the house of God forever. And ever, amen. Aren't you glad you found the house of God?
Amen.
Aren't you glad you escaped the house of man? Aren't you glad to be a member of the church of Christ?
Yes.
Him I declare unto you and you and you and all of you. And if you're not a member of the church of Christ, you become a member by hearing the word of God, which you have did in Romans 10, verse number 17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God is the process of becoming a Christian. Have you heard the word? Do you believe what you heard in Mark 16 and 16? He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. Am I right?
Great.
Have you seen Luke 13 and 3? Nay, I tell you, except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. Acts 17 in the text and verse number 30, that in the time of those ignorance, God winked at. But now, what even in the time of multiplicity of churches, God winked at.
Uh-huh.
But now I command you, every one of you, to repent from even saying that there's a multiplicity of churches. That's the repentance in Acts 17 and 30, that everybody's not God, every church is not the church, there's but one God and one church. I looked at this English one time and winked at it, but now I command you, I direct you, I command you to find my church.
Amen.
Stop telling everybody else in the church to do. He don't need your help. Why are you doing it? Because you think you can thank for God. Mm-hmm. You think you can thank for God. Mm-hmm. And Romans, Paul was trying to tell him in Romans, he said, who has been God's counselor? Mm-hmm. Who's been God's counselor? Who has known the mind of God?
Well.
And who's been his counselor? Who are you to sit back and start talking about, well, I don't think God is that narrow-minded. You don't think for God.
Amen.
Who do you think you are? You can't even think your checkbook straight.
Amen.
You can't keep your lights on. Say amen when you can.
Amen.
What you mean? You can't even pick out a good man or woman. What you talking? What you mean you don't think? Stop thinking and start doing what God says to do.
Amen.
And God says in his word, and he said, you got to be baptized.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to keep on quoting John 3 and verse number 3, that a man is born of the water and the spirit. I'll keep quoting 1 Peter 3, 19 through 21, that baptism doth also save us today. It is not the washing of the body, but an answer to a good conscience toward God. Why? Because baptism puts us in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Romans chapter 6, 1 through 8. Baptism is a burial into the death, burial, and resurrection of God. Why? I'm going to keep preaching that in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 17, 2 Corinthians 5, verse number 17, that baptism, that if any man be in Christ Jesus, he's a new creature.
Mm-hmm.
The old things are passed away, and all things are new. Well, how do I get my sins washed away? You got to go down into the watery grave of baptism.
Amen.
Galatians chapter 3 and verse number 27, for many of us that have been baptized have put on Christ. Don't let folk tell you don't have to be baptized. You have to be baptized into his body. The body is the church of Christ.
Man.
I didn't say it, God said it.
Yes.
Man. You're not a member of the church of Christ. You're in trouble.
Man.
You need to get right before it's everlasting and alert and eternity later. Now, before I take any of it back, I add 15 more minutes. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'll stand flat footed and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
It's the power unto salvation to the Jew first. And also the Greeks, even the Greeks in Acts 17. I done broke a button on my suit. That means God said, sit down.
Amen.
Amen. May God bless you. The song leader sang. May God keep you.
May God
keep you. Just come up, give me a hand, God. Your heart, heaven's waiting.